Hey guys, it's Jamov with Jamov Pickup, and today we're going to talk about vasectomies. So for those of you that do not know that term, it's basically where you have a procedure done, a medical operation, which causes sperm, right? Your testicles, your balls produce sperm, right? Causes the sperm from being, from entering into your semen, okay? So, the reason why guys do this, a lot of married men will do this, right? They have like their two kids or their three kids. They're like, I don't want to have any kids anymore. I don't want to use condoms with my wife. I don't want her to have birth control that might mess up her hormones and make her have weight gain or like crazed emotions, whatever, right? So the most common way that guys will get this is after they're done having kids, all right? But today I want to discuss all the benefits and actually the lack of downsides, right? A lot of people think there's a lot of downsides to this and there's a lot of myths out there. So I want to dispel those myths and kind of cover the facts so that people can consider this as a real option. So for those of you that follow my channel, I've been with over 700 girls. At the date of this video, it's 735 different girls. And that's new sexual partners, okay? So that's not just 735 chances to get a girl pregnant, it's 735 times the number of times I had sex with each one, right? So it's tens of thousands, if not over 100,000 chances to impregnate a girl. So in 2014, I actually was out at a club. I pulled home this really hot Czechoslovakian girl, ended up banging her like six times that night, or five, you know, it was a whole bunch of times that night, in the morning a couple more times, right? So I remember thinking like I banged this chick like seven or eight times, it was fucking awesome. She was really hot, it was cool. And we were texting the next day and everything was awesome, we had good chemistry, and she wanted to meet up again. And then she kind of disappeared and I was like, what the fuck? Like, sometimes that happens, sometimes they feel guilty about banging you too soon, or their friends judge them, or they judge themselves, or whatever. But it seemed out of place, right? And I ran into her a few months later at the club, and she was like, I got pregnant that night. And I remember she had told me that night that she was on birth control, and it was okay to come inside of her, and I remember I came inside of her a whole bunch, and she ended up getting pregnant. And I was like, are you pregnant now? Like, what's going on? And she's like, no, I went and got an abortion, but I didn't know how to tell you, and the whole thing was embarrassing, blah, blah, blah. And I was like, holy shit, right? And then a few months later, I was dating this, Peruvian girl, really hot, fake tits. She was a dentist and she was a bikini model. So she was successful. She was sexy. She made good money, right? She was cool, hot, but she had like that Latina, like, you know, like sassy kind of a little bit crazy side where she would kind of like be like, not everyone can handle this poppy and all this shit, right? And she would, you know, not being racist, but she would just like, you know, be very, very sassy for no reason a lot of times, which a lot of times can happen with Hispanic girls, all right? So, long story short, we're hooking up regularly. She was on the pill as well, and she ended up getting pregnant. And she told me, she's like, this is my choice, not yours. I want to have the kid. I'm in love with you. I want to have a family. I want to raise a child together. And first of all, I didn't want to be with this girl long term. She wasn't my girlfriend. Like, we had been sleeping together for a few months, but I didn't want to be with her long term. This was in San Diego, but I was planning on moving to Miami soon. I was also starting a business. You know, I had my pickup business, but I was also starting another business. I didn't want to have to get docked in my pay for like 18 years, or depending on the state that you live in the U.S., it can be up to 21 years if it's a female, like in New York State, for instance, if you have a daughter. And it's like 25% of your pay, I think, is the rate. And if you have multiple kids with multiple women, it's like cumulative. So like if you have two separate children, it's like half your pay is gone and then taxes on top of that. So not to sound like shallow or sound like a dickhead, but this is like if you're fucking hundreds of girls, and then if you watch my channel and you study these videos, you're going to learn how to sleep with 100 girls a year, right? So like, that's a lot of volume. That's, a, you know, raising the chances that you're going to have a kid. and condoms like aren't perfect solution either. Like, if you regularly have sex, or you can just Google this, some condoms break. Okay, so if you haven't experienced this firsthand, this is like a real thing. Sometimes they fall off and you don't realize. Like, you can be having sex with a girl, it can slide off, and then you finish and you think it's in a condom, and then oops, the condom's inside of her and you just came inside of her, right? If you're having unprotected sex and the girl's on the pill, she can forget to take the pill any given time. She can also take her birth control at the wrong times, okay? So, like, you're facing, like, all these risks. Or even worse, like, if we're going to explore all options here, the girl can lie to you and say she's on the pill. I've had friends this has happened to. She can lie to you. Like, if a girl's trying to, like, quote-unquote, wife a guy up, like, she wants to marry this guy, and the guy, like, maybe isn't feeling it, she can kind of, like, corner him into the situation by being like, oh, yeah, I'm on the pill still, blah, 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 like, or you know, not say anything and stop taking it. And the guy's coming inside, and all of a sudden he has a baby, and now he has to, like, move in with the girl and, like, start a whole life with the girl. And I know multiple people who this has happened to. So all that being said, this Peruvian girl, I'm like, listen, I don't want to have a long-term future with you. I don't want to have a child right now. I'm not ready to be a father or raise a family. I think it would be the responsible decision if we had an abortion. And she said, no, like, I'm against that, and, like, I really love you and I want to have this long thing with you and all this stuff. And so this was really, really, really stressful for me. We went back and forth for like a whole month where I was like, I don't want it. She's like, I want it. And I was like, no. And she's like, it's my decision. And it just went back and forth. And I was like losing sleep over this. Like, imagine, like, you're bringing a child into the world. For any of you that haven't, I mean, most of you haven't gone through this, I'm sure. Imagine you're like bringing a child into the world that you didn't want to bring into the world, right? It's a financial, again, I'm not being shallow at all, I'm just stating the facts. It's a financial burden to you because it's detracting money out of your check. That's even if you're not raising it. Like, I have friends, and I'm just using this example from my own life, but there are people that are out there that are, plenty of people that are paying for children that they don't know or they're not raising, right? Like, I have my best friend from college, he had a one-night stand with a girl, so they had sex one time. And she was like, oh, I'm on the pill, it's okay, you can come inside. He came inside, and he gets contacted 5 years later. I got pregnant, I've been raising the child. He got court ordered to be DNA tested, and it turned out to be his. He had to pay 5 years back child support. He has to pay for that child till she's 21. He's never met the child, not because he's an asshole. It's just because she's raising it with another man. He has no bond with this woman, no connection with this woman. It was a one-night stand, right? But now his pay is impacted for all those years. Say that she did, you know, but there's also situations where the child is being raised by just a single mother, right? Like, say you're not ready to have a family, or you move cities or whatever. Now it's that child is growing up without a father. So there's the financial impact, there's the impact on the child if you don't want to be part of its life and it doesn't have a different father as a replacement. There's just all kinds of problems, right? The BS you have to deal with the girl you got pregnant, where, like, you have maybe a custody battle, maybe you want this child and she doesn't want to give it up. I can just go on and on, but you guys can understand. And it may seem like, oh, this will never happen to me, but again, condoms break, girls lie about being on the pill, girls take their birth control wrong, accidents happen, the condom can fall off by accident. Even like situations where, like, you're using the pull-out method, like the sperm, there have been studies on this, like the semen can, like, come out before you have the mental sensation that you're going to orgasm and that you're going to come. So, like, that first, like, shot of semen can go in, not to be gross, but, like, that can go in before you have the sensation you need to pull out, and that can cause a baby. Even if you pull out in time with plenty of time to spare and you go a second round, like, there's still sperm, like, in the tubes, like, it can fucking still go in when you go back in a second round. So I hope I've convinced you, like, this is a real problem, especially as you fuck more and more volume of women. And like I used in the example of my best friend from college, it just takes one time. All right, so enough about that. Let's get into the myths around a vasectomy. So this is the most common thing. Okay, so I got a vasectomy. After this Peruvian girl, like, I convinced her to get an abortion. She finally got an abortion. Huge nightmare and annoyance. And, you know, she, it was like early on enough where she could take pills. So it was like a delayed morning after. It wasn't like a vacuum procedure or whatever, okay? So, like, I'm not even getting into the debate about, you know, is abortion right or wrong, whatever. That's a separate discussion. So, in this particular, or, okay, so I got a vasectomy October 2014. But I went to the doctor and I was like, I've heard that people who can get chronic pain when they have this procedure. I've heard that it might decrease libido. It might decrease like duration of erections or frequency of getting erections. Is it actually like effective? Like, can I get girls pregnant still by accident if some sperm gets through? Am I never going to be able to have children again? Like, I asked all these questions and I talked to the doctor for several hours. And I went to a doctor in San Diego that was one of the top 10 in the nation. Okay, so he had performed over 7,000 vasectomies and basically devoted his life to just doing regular vasectomies. So I'm a very technical and scientific guy as well, and very smart guy. And I went into like all the technical details about how all this works. So I'll go into the myths in a second, but the most common one, whenever I tell anyone that I've had a vasectomy, they say, oh, so you never want kids, right? And I don't know if I ever want kids, but they're basically assuming if you have a vasectomy that you can never have children, okay? So that's myth number one. If you have a vasectomy, you can never have children. Completely false. So first of all, the doctor explained how you freeze a bunch of sperm, right? So you basically are like masturbating into a collection thing, and you freeze enough to have, you know, you can freeze as much as you want. I froze enough to have like seven kids, right? Up to seven kids if I ever want them. But it's also reversible. Like, this particular doctor had a reversal rate of 97%, right? And he's like, listen, I can reverse this for you anytime. He's like, I have a really high reversal rate, really high success rate. But I'll tell you right now, you never need to reverse it if you freeze the sperm. And he's like, also with this frozen sperm, you can choose sperm that like does it, that, because we know a lot about science now and genetics. You can choose sperm if and when you're ready to have a child with a woman. You can choose sperm that doesn't have developmental disorders like autism or Down syndrome. And you can also choose the sex of the child. Like, again, I'm not getting into the other debates here, like, oh, that's playing God or whatever. But you can have, but if you freeze sperm, you can later look at the sperm and make sure that the baby does not have retardation or developmental disorders. And you can choose the sex of the child and all these other things. I've even watched recent genomics videos where you can tell by certain sperm egg combinations what the height of the child will be, what its face will look like at all the points of its life, what its voice tone will sound like. So our technology is getting so advanced, you can actually use this genetic information to basically like pick a child or build a child or whatever you want to call it. I'm not going to get into the ethical implications of that, but that's one potential benefit. Another is he told me that your sperm is more vital when you are younger, right? So I froze the sperm at age 30. I'm now 33. And if and when I want children, it's better that I'm using sperm from a younger age. The second myth is just kind of like this whole like, oh, you know, it's taking away my manhood or erections or libido problems. He showed me in a diagram. So like, quick lesson on anatomy with human male genitals is the vas deferens is the tube in the body that inserts sperm into your semen, okay? Now, all the vasectomy is doing, this is a really important key fact here, all the vasectomy is doing is blocking the vas deferens from putting sperm into your semen, okay? That has nothing to do with your libido and your hormones, right? So your libido will be the same. Has nothing to do with your ability to get an erection or your frequency of erections or your duration of erections. That's a process caused by arousal. Not going to go into all that, but it's blood flowing to the penis. It has nothing to do with the vas deferens putting sperm into your semen. Also, like this, like some people think like, oh, I'm not a man anymore because I don't have sperm. You are still producing sperm just the same as everyone else. It's just blocked. That's literally the only thing this procedure is doing, is it's blocking sperm from going into your semen. Okay, that's all it's doing. So like, you're still producing sperm. Your erections are the same. Your libido is the same. Your manhood is the same. That brings me to my next point, though. Oh, well, like, I asked the doctor this. I was like, am I going to, like, shoot blanks? Like, when I orgasm, like, what's happening? Like, I'm not going to come? Like, what's happening there, right? Some people think, like, oh, I'm less of a man if I'm not coming. That's a myth as well. He told me, listen, your semen, like, load, so to speak, or, like, quantity, like, the amount of semen you have, only 5% of that is sperm, okay? So semen is the fluid that transports the sperm, and only 5% of that volume is actual sperm, which are like microscopic, that's your, you know, DNA that's going through to implant the egg, okay? So, no, you're not shooting blanks, right? Based on how frequently you masturbate or how frequently you have sex, you're gonna have varying quantities of semen even without a vasectomy. A vasectomy is just going to decrease that volume by 5%, which isn't anything. It's negligible, right? Like, I haven't noticed any difference subjectively. I've had the procedure for 3 years. It's negligible, right? It's just removing these microscopic genetic carriers out of that fluid. But you still produce that fluid when you orgasm, when you masturbate, or when you have sex, okay? So no, you don't shoot blanks. It's essentially the exact same quantity. It's only 5% less of fluid. Your erections are the same, your libido is the same, your manhood is still intact. Okay, so what else? I asked him, what is the effectiveness of this, right? And he said, well, his procedures are extremely effective because he blocks the vas deferens in 7 different ways. I don't even remember what all the ways are anymore, but I know he's like tying it. He's cauterizing it with heat, so he's like sealing it shut with heat. And again, I'll explain how the procedure works and how it happened and all that stuff, and it's not that big of a deal. But he's blocking it in like 7 different ways, so it's like really difficult. I don't know if it's impossible, but like virtually impossible for the semen or for the sperm to get into the semen if it's done correctly. And so what I did was, he said, after 10 weeks after the procedure, you're going to go in and have a sperm count. And that's just to verify that the procedure was effective. So, because the reason for that 10 weeks is there's still like some lingering sperm like in the whole like pipeline or whatever. I don't know exactly the technical details of that. I went at the 10-week mark and my sperm count was 0, which means not that I had stopped producing sperm, but just that it was effectively blocked. And the sperm, as a technical point here, the sperm that you are producing when you have the vasectomy, it's just getting blocked at the vas deferens. It's being reabsorbed into the body and excreted in other ways, but it's not going to be ejaculated into a woman when you have sex. So I asked him also about chronic pain. I said, I don't want to have, you know, that's another thing that kind of floats around in the common opinion about a vasectomy. Oh, well, what if I get chronic pain? I don't want to have pain in my testicles for life, or, you know, even intermittent, right? So I said, is that going to be a problem? And he said, I said, what is the risk of that? And he said, that comes from the procedure being done incorrectly. So some people will go to like their family doctor or someone, other kind of doctor that's inexperienced with this procedure, and the procedure is done wrong and errors are made, and that's what causes the pain. So the guy I went to, and for those of you that are interested in actually doing this, and I'm hopefully by the end of this video it makes a lot more sense about why you should do this, but you should be going to a urologist, okay? A urologist is a specialty doctor, and you want to find a doctor that specializes in vasectomies. So my particular doctor, he had done over 7,000. He had a very renowned reputation and an esteemed track record. And so I went to a doctor that basically wasn't going to fuck shit up, right? Now, some of the stuff you see on the forums, if you look about the chronic pain, again, only people that are having an issue are going to report that, and not everyone is going to a urologist. So I would be willing to bet that most of those people went to a doctor that was a family doctor or that didn't have much experience doing these procedures. And this is true for like any kind of medical procedure. Like if a chick was going to get like a breast implant, right? Good breast implants, you want to get under the muscle, You want to get high profile silicone or gummy bear implant. You want it to be about 450 to 500 cc's, maybe a little bigger based on your body type, and they can show you with computer imagery what it will look like. And you want to go to a renowned doctor in Miami or Las Vegas or New York or LA, right, Los Angeles. And you're going to spend about $7,000 or $8,000. But some girls are like, oh, I'm going to do saline. I'm going to do under the nipple. I'm going to fly to some foreign country or go to some, you know, half-wit doctor, and I'm going to only pay $3,000. I'm going to save money. And what ends up happening is, here, I'll move the camera down here so you can see. By the way, I'm shouting out my 700 level shirt here. It's, I got that once I cleared 700 different closes. You have what's called the refund gap, right? So you have like these breast implants and you have this big gap in between, right? Or you have the girl's nipples are like lopsided, right? Like they don't, like here's like, it's kind of hard because the camera's upside down here. Here's like properly aligned nipples. When you try to save money or go to a shitty doctor, you have like these misaligned nipples, right? So like these girls are like, oh, I'm going to save money and go to, you know, a guy that's cheaper. I'm going to get a cheaper procedure. And what ends up happening is the breasts look worse. They feel worse. The girl might have problems. Like she might need to get them replaced sooner, et cetera, et cetera. So the same principle applies here. Like if you're going to do this procedure, go to a guy that knows what he's doing, and you can look up reviews on Google, on, you know, these different sites. Let's see. So I covered that there's, you know, no danger of risking erection problems or libido problems. You're not going to shoot blanks. It's still going to be the same amount of volume. Yes, you can still have children. And not only can you freeze sperm, but the procedure is also reversible. What else we need to cover? Okay, so the details of the procedure, it took about 15 minutes. So it's very quick. You're not being put under. So you're not taking like some kind of injection like you would normally in a hospital procedure and going unconscious. You're not being put under. You're awake and there's no pain. They're using a local anesthetic and it's a micro incision, right? The technology is very advanced now. So it's a micro incision in your testicles, right? So they're making a tiny incision and there's local anesthetic so you can't feel any pain. And he's going there, he's tying off the vas deferens, he's cauterizing it with heat and whatever other stuff he did, I don't remember. But you're awake the whole time, you're just relaxing. I didn't feel any pain. I felt slight pressure when he was doing the tying, like you feel like a pressure. Same thing if you had like a cavity filled at the dentist, you're awake, they apply a numbing agent, and you're feeling like the drill, like you're feeling the pressure on your tooth, but you're not feeling any pain. So that's the best analogy I can give you. It's also very cheap. With insurance, it's under $1,000. If you have an accidental child, you're going to pay a lot more than $1,000 over those 18 or 21 years, and all the qualitative impacts on your life as well. Let's see. Yeah, if I'm giving you my straight up honest opinion, like the procedure was a piece of cake. The only like slightly scary slash weird part was when he was cauterizing, and cauterization basically means like sealing something shut with heat. So when he was like sealing the vas deferens shut with heat, there was like some smoke billowing up, like literally from your balls. And that might weird a lot of you guys out or like think it's fucking crazy or something. But again, as a highly trained professional, he's done this tons of times. There's really nothing to worry about, right? Like a little bit of smoke, not a big deal. Okay. And then you have some pain, like sort of intense for the first week. The first like 2 or 3 days are the worst, where it just kind of feels like someone kicked you in the balls. It's not that big of a deal. You wear an athletic supporter cup and, you know, you take a couple days off work where you're just kind of like relaxing in bed. You're not doing any kind of like strenuous physical activity. Same thing if the girls get their boobs done, they're kind of like in a bed for a few days or a week. After the first week, it's kind of a piece of cake. I think I still wore the cup. After like a month, the pain's like mostly gone. So like, week one, you have like some pain, but you have like painkillers and stuff too, I'm pretty sure is what I had. And then the next 3 weeks after that, you know, within that first month, it's like slightly inconvenient, but not that big of a deal. And then that's it. And you're not supposed to have sex, I think, for the first 3 weeks or first 4 weeks or something like that. Because you're not like supposed to fuck with all the, again, piping or whatever is the encompassing term to refer to all the stuff down there. But what's cool is he had done 7,000 of these, and I was like, okay, so I can't, you're telling me I can't fuck. I was like, can I fuck and like not come? And he's like, I've done 7,000 of these and no one's ever asked that question. But like, as you all know from watching my channel, like I have lots of sexual partners, lots of, I'm doing all this seduction and pickup stuff, regularly having sex with new girls. And especially with the girls I was already seeing, I didn't want to like go 2 or 3 weeks without fucking them because I didn't want to have them like go seek sex elsewhere. Even though they're really into me, I didn't want to have to like deprive them of sex as well, or myself. So I was like, can I have sex and not come? And he's like, yeah, technically you can. He's like, no one's ever asked that, but you can. He's like, but why would you want to do that? What's the point of having sex then? And like, I've had other people say that to me before too, about like, you know, like guys that have trouble coming and stuff. They're like, why would I even bother having sex? Say you have sex for like 30 minutes or 45 minutes or even 15 minutes, whatever the time frame is. You're only orgasming for like the last 10 seconds, right? It's not like the rest of the time is miserable or pointless, right? Like an orgasm is amazing, yes, and it's the best part, but you're enjoying that sexual act for those 15, 30, 45 minutes, and that's 99.9% of the time anyways. So, you know, whatever, I just fucking bit the bullet and didn't come and still had sex, which wasn't, it's not that much different. It's like the entire experience minus the very end, which, you know, whatever. Okay, so I'm trying to think of what else I need to cover. Oh, the sperm freezing. Okay, so I went and did 3 separate collections, and each collection had to be 48 hours apart. You basically go and they give you a little plastic thing, and you take it to a room, you masturbate into the cup, and then you can't come back sooner than 48 hours because you have to like rebuild up enough sperm. And they freeze that, and those methods are all very advanced. You know, the technology is very good, so you don't need to worry about like, oh, like is my sperm gonna go bad or something. That's all very well controlled as well. And it was literally $300 total for the first 3 years. That's it, $300. And what actually made me think to make this video is that I had a calendar reminder in my phone for 3 years ahead, and it actually just hit because I got this procedure done about 3 years ago and 2 weeks. So now I just send in another payment to renew, but it's very cheap to freeze it. Compared to like an egg, like a female reproductive egg, is actually very expensive to freeze. Let's see. Okay, so we covered, you can still have kids, you freeze the sperm, which is very cheap. The procedure is also reversible. My particular doctor had a 95% or 97% or something reversal rate, almost never didn't work, but you never need to do the reversal if you do the sperm freezing. Your sperm are more vital when they are younger, so that's like a good argument for doing the freezing, even if you're not getting a vasectomy. Like I had a lawyer friend who did sperm freezing just for that reason. He didn't even have a vasectomy, he just did it because he wanted to be able to choose the sex of his child and weed out developmental disorders, and also because of the factor of it being more vital when you're younger. Doesn't affect erections, doesn't affect libido, you don't shoot blanks, it's essentially the same exact amount of sperm or of semen, it's 5% less. The chronic pain, that's only an issue if you go to a bad doctor. What else to cover? It's a cheap procedure, it's a quick procedure, the healing time is fast. Okay, now I'll kind of give like an argument why I think you guys should do this. Unless you're here's my argument basically. If you are sexually active, which I assume everyone watching this channel is, or at least wants to be in the near future, and also not currently trying to have a baby with a wife or even like a girlfriend or like a girl, like if you're not planning on with whatever girl or I don't want to say girls, if you're not trying to have a baby like the next time you have sex, then you should get this procedure. Like if you're not currently trying to be a father, there's no reason to roll the dice, even if you're using condoms, right? Like, if you're not using condoms, this, the argument applies even stronger because you could not pull out in time. If you're coming inside a girl on the pill, she could be lying about being on the pill, or she could take the birth control wrong. But even if you are using condoms, like I said before, condoms can break, condoms can slide off. And these aren't even like rare occurrences. Like, condoms can break, especially if you're like going doggy style and you've done a couple of positions and the condom is like pulled tight on your penis. Like, it's actually like somewhat common for the condom to break just from all the pressure being applied from the doggy style position. And also, another side point is most people prefer the thin condoms because they feel the best, right? Like the Trojan Ultra Thin, Trojan Bearskin, other types of condoms that are thin, and the thinner condoms have a greater likelihood of breaking, okay? So all that being said, my argument is basically each time you have sex with a girl, you're taking a risk, right, of getting her pregnant. So I just went through all that. I don't need to go through it again. You know, there's greater risk if you're not using condoms, but even with condoms, there's still a risk. And as I showed you in that example with my friend from college, it just takes one time and then you have a baby. And some women are against abortions, like, completely. Like, I have friends and there are other people that exist that got a girl pregnant and the woman is like, no way, I'm morally opposed to it, I'm religiously opposed to it, we're not having an abortion, there's no way. And the guy can't do anything about that. Like, the woman can have the baby and he's on the hook for child support at a minimum. And possibly, if he wants to be part of that child's life, custody battles over the child being raised by some other man out of his control, right? Whoever the woman brings into the picture to be like the father figure when the child is with that man. It's just a whole host of problems, right? You can imagine. And also, let's see. I mean, there's just no reason to take that risk. Like, it seems extreme before you understand all these facts I've described about a vasectomy. It seems extreme to get a vasectomy from a common layman perspective, right? Like a layman, or like someone who doesn't know about, like, I didn't know that much about them. Like, the common myths out there, like, you have this procedure, there's like, you lose your manhood, you can't have kids ever again, it's permanent, it's risky, you know, people have no idea how much it costs or how easy it is, or any of the facts and scientific and technical points that actually matter, right? So I don't feel like I've lost any of my manhood. I'm still producing sperm. Literally everything is the same. I just have like this one little tube blocked that's preventing accidental pregnancies. It's ingenious. It's essential. I wish I did it sooner. And if and when I'm ready to have a child, I go and take this vital sperm and make a child, and I could choose, you know, to make sure it's not growing up with some kind of developmental disorder, make sure, or I could choose the sex of it. I could even get into the further points I raised before about, I could choose what its face is going to look like and what its voice is going to sound like and how tall it is and all this shit. Again, that might not be your cup of tea, but it doesn't matter. The point is, and this is the final and overarching point I want to make, you should be having a child on your terms, not accidentally and then adjusting your entire life and your entire finances because of an accident, okay? And a lot of you, like myself, even before I had this procedure done, think like, oh, that's just some, you know, accidental pregnancies or something that happened to other people. It actually happened to me twice that year. You know, it's not, I'm not laughing because like, oh, I had these catastrophes and had abortions. It was just very eye-opening. Like, I'm fucking hundreds of women, like, multiple times. Like, I'm usually having sex with girls all the time, right? So, like, this is a big irresponsible thing to not have this procedure done. It's not enough to just wear a condom. It's not enough to just be careful with pulling out. It's not enough to make sure all your partners are on birth control. You are going to run into situations where you have accidents. And the more girls you sleep with, the more this is going to happen. Like, let's say you're only going to sleep with, like, two more people or one more person before you settle down and had a child. It's still a risk. You can impregnate that one person, those two people. So I'm not going to beat a dead horse here, but I highly recommend getting this procedure done. It's pretty much affordable to anyone. it's not going to impact your life very much. Like, it's a minor inconvenience for a week, a little bit more up to a month, but very, very minor, with the pain as it heals. You can still have children. You know, none of your manly functions are going to be impacted. And, you know, it's better to just act as soon as possible and do this, because, you know, it's better to be preventative than have to deal with this kind of accident after the fact. And the reason why I want to make this video is because a lot of you has as goal to sleep with more and more women, which is great. Like, that's my goal as well. You know, like, meet lots of amazing women, have lots of amazing emotional and physical relationships with them. But as you get better at this, you're going to sleep with more girls, which is going to raise the odds that you have an accidental child. So I'll leave you with that. Again, remember, you should be having a child on your own terms, if you want one and when you want one. Not, you know, I could tell you story after story about guys that had to basically stop all their pickup and seduction stuff and become a dad or become a family man, because, or have their finances, like, really fucked with for a long time, just because a condom fell off one time, or a condom broke one time, or some chick lied about being on birth control or took it wrong. So, thank you for watching. Hope this was very helpful. And if you guys need recommendations, hit me up for doctors in your area. I know a lot of the best ones. So, thank you so much, and we'll talk soon. Thank you for watching.